Who is it visible? Screen. Yeah, I can respond. Is it visible? Okay. Okay, that's fine. Okay, let me try to revise yesterday's session. Yeah, what is the problem that we faced in the yesterday's class regarding this learning rate parameter? Do you require high learning rate or do you require very low learning rate? Which one you require? You can respond. No, do you require high or low learning rate parameter alpha? Which one you require in general?
Moderate.
Moderate, right? For example, and that too, it depends upon the problem to problem, that will vary. For example, if I consider very low learning rate in this particular problem, this alpha equal to n power minus 3 looks very, very low value for this particular problem. After 1000 iterations, you are coming from this point, this omega naught equals to 1, 2, till this point, after 1000 iterations. You took 1000 iterations to come from this point to this point. It requires so much time for this, right? It's a problem with slow learning rate or very small learning rate. There is an issue with high learning rate also. For example, if I'm starting somewhere here, some omega naught somewhere here, and if my learning rate is so high, what can happen is in one step I can reach to this point. After that, in the second step, I can reach to this point. Third step, I can reach to this point. I can keeps on fluctuating between these two points. Keeps on fluctuating between these two points. That may happen. If my learning rate is so high, it might oscillate, it might never converge to this minimum point. It's also possible. And some cases, it might diverge also. If my learning rate parameter is very, very high, for example, 1.045, in this particular example, then what happens is it keeps on diverging, right? First iteration, second iteration, third, fourth, like this. After 10 iterations, we are ending up at this point. Instead of going towards this, we are going farther from this, right? It's diverging instead of converging. These are the problems with very high learning rate parameter and with very low learning rate parameters. Let's see a brief summarization of this. Epoch corresponds to iteration number. Epoch is same as iteration. Like that, you can think. It's a iteration numbers. Number of iterations keeps on increasing along this x-axis. And what's happening, we are going to see here. It's a loss function. If you are having very good learning rate, then what happens is this will try to learn a little bit faster and this will try to converge to minimum point. See, loss is becoming smaller and smaller, right? As the number of iterations are increasing. The loss function is becoming smaller and smaller as the number of iterations are increasing. This is with good learning rate. And this is with the low learning rate. This blue curve. As the number of iterations are increasing, loss function is decreasing, but at a slower rate. You may require more number of iterations to approach to minimum point for your loss function. This may require so many iterations. There's a problem with this low learning rate. And if you go for high learning rate, the loss will keep on decreasing up to some point at a faster rate. Within few iterations, your loss decreased to this point, right? You can compare with this red curve and blue curve. Suppose if I took this iteration number, this green curve looks very, very low, right? This loss function value compared to red and blue. But the problem with this one is this might be oscillating, right? After reaching to that point, it's not decreasing further. It's a case where you see such cases. This one. I can start somewhere here, for example, with high learning rate. After first iteration, I might end up here. Second iteration, I might go to this. Third iteration, like this. Fourth, fifth, like this. And keeps on oscillating, right? This is that case. This green curve corresponds to that one. And the number of iterations are increasing. I'm decreasing my loss function very fast as compared to these two. But after some time, what's happening? It keeps on oscillating between those two losses, right? See with high learning rate, problem with high learning rate. The learning rate parameter alpha is very, very high, like this, then that may diverge. Instead of decreasing loss function, you are going to get increase in your loss function. That increase in your loss value. This is that case, this one. In this case, loss is increasing, right? Y coordinate is loss. Is my first iteration, second iteration, third iteration, my loss is increasing, right? Fourth iteration. So y coordinate is loss. Loss is keeps on increasing. You can see this y coordinate for these iterations. For the 10th iteration, this is my loss. For the starting point, this is my loss. This loss looks very high compared to this one, right? It's diverging. Increasing loss function value, right? The problem with very, very high learning rate. This yellow curve. Yeah, is there any suggestions from your side how to select your learning rate parameter? So you can think on answer. I want to take the benefit of this high learning rate. You can see. For example, within five iterations, my loss function is becoming very, very low for this high learning rate. After that, this is oscillating. Now, can I shift to this low learning rate from this point? Is it possible? See, what my question is, this is iteration number one or epoch. And this is my loss, that L of W, like that you can think, loss function value. With the high learning rate parameter, I am trying to get something like this with high learning rate parameter. The number of iterations are increasing. For example, this 0th iteration, first, second iteration, third, fourth iteration, fifth iteration, sixth, like this. This is with high learning rate parameter, high alpha. And I'll try to consider the case with low alpha. I can say moderate alpha. Can you suggest some trick? where I can converge to my solution bit faster. Yeah, any trick? Let me call this like alpha 1. Let me call this like alpha 2. I give hint, indirectly I'm giving hint for you. Yes, you can suggest, try something. In this case, the problem I'm going to face is, if I go with high learning rate parameter alpha 1, this is loss function is decreasing very fast up to some point. After that, that's not decreasing at all, the loss function. It's oscillating. My target is I want to have as much low loss as possible. That's my target. If I go with moderate learning rate parameter or some slow learning rate parameter, this is diverging, this is converging to minimum point, but it's taking so many iterations, few hundreds of iterations to go to the minimum point. Then what can you do? Can you do any mix kind of thing? Yeah, one of you can answer. I want to go for some switching. Will you go with alpha 1 first or will you go with alpha 2 first? I'm giving one more hint. Up to first few iterations, I'll take alpha 1. After that, I'll go with alpha 2. This is case 1. And case 2 is, first few iterations, I'll go with alpha 2. After that, I'll go with alpha 1. Which one will you prefer? Alpha 1 is high, alpha 2 is moderate. Yes, you can answer, right?
First one.
Yeah, what happens if you follow this first one? Due to high learning rate parameter for the first few iterations, I'm trying to go up to this point very fast. For example, let's say, yeah, instead of 1, 2, 3 iteration, let me go for some realistic one. After 10 iterations, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 80, 90, 100 iterations. Like that I am considering. This is 25th iterations. For example, this is 25th iteration. This is just for demonstration purpose, this one. It means up to 25 iterations, my learning rate parameter will be alpha 1. I came to this loss function very fast, right? Drastically. Instead of this one, if I start with alpha 1, alpha 2, in order to reach to this loss level, how many iterations I require with alpha 2? You can see, right? With alpha 2, with this learning rate parameter alpha 2, how many iterations you require to reach to this point?
60,
right? 60 is very big compared to 25, right? It's very high. In order to avoid this one, what I am doing is, up to few iterations, for example, 25 iterations, I will set my learning rate parameter alpha to alpha 1, bit higher. And after that, I'll try to switch my alpha to alpha 2, this one. Till 25 iterations. You see, after 25 iterations. This is just for demonstration, this is not exact one. Because this may not applicable for all problems. This will vary from problem to problem. Up to this, I will follow alpha 1. And after that, if I am following alpha 1, it keeps on oscillating. This is not decreasing in loss function further, right? In that scenario, what I can do is, I can switch to alpha 2. From this point onwards, I can switch to alpha 2. It means, I am going to replicate this at this point, right? I'm just moving this entire curve to this point. That's what I'm doing. Here I am following alpha 2. This is a benefit I am going to get. It means what I can do is, I can slowly decrease my alpha, right? I can slowly decrease my alpha. This is decreasing. In some steps means after some iterations, for example, after 20 iterations, after 30 iterations, whatever you want, you can try to decrease this alpha. Yeah, I saw some people will try to apply this one. Initially, they will start with some high alpha value. After that, they'll try to make alpha by 2 after few iterations. After few more iterations, they'll try to make alpha by 4. This is a learning rate parameter, updated one. After few more iterations, they'll try to make it like alpha by 8. Like that, they will try to do. This is high. Alpha is so high. As the iterations goes and goes, they'll try to decrease this alpha value. That's what they will do in general. Maybe after 20 iterations or after 40 iterations, after 60 iterations, this one, like that. That means my learning rate parameter should be adaptable, right? If alpha is adaptable, then it's well and good, right? I can reach to my solution with faster rate. If alpha is very high, it may not imply that you can reach to solution fastly. That might oscillate. Alpha should be adaptable. The learning rate should be adaptable, right? This is just for introducing notations. It's an error surface, a loss function. This can be called as loss function. This y coordinate is loss function. Or we can say this is z coordinate. See z, x, y coordinates. It's 3D, right? Let's say this is x coordinate, and this is y coordinate, and this is z coordinate. This z coordinate corresponds to loss function. And these are the two parameters I am having, W1, W2. Earlier we gone with only one parameter, right? We are trying to minimize the loss function with respect to W. Here we want to minimize the loss function with respect to two parameters, W1, W2. You can try to control this W1 and W2 in order to reduce your loss function, L of W1, W2. Earlier you tried to control, or you are trying to control that parameter W, in order to minimize the loss function L of W. That's your relay target. You have only one parameter or one weight W. In this case, you are having two parameters or two weights, W1, W2. You want to tune this W1 and W2. Okay, this is called as error surface. Yeah, one of you can answer, what is the meaning of this red color here? Is it high loss or low loss? See, z coordinate is loss. Is it representing high loss or low loss? This red color. See, if this coordinate is high, then loss is high. Like that you can think. Is it representing high or low? What about blue color? It's a blue color. It's a red color. Blue color is somewhere nearby this, right? This ground. Red color is somewhere far away from this ground, right? Okay, which one is high loss function? red or blue in this representation? Yes, you can answer. You can see this, right? Straight away, this red color is somewhere around this, right? If you draw parallel line to this one, it's intersecting somewhere here. Red corresponds to high loss. Blue corresponds to low loss. If you try to have parallel line like this, that might be intersecting somewhere below 5, right? It's above 40, this red one. If you are approaching to red color, it means that is high loss. This is a low loss region, this blue color in this representation. And what is the meaning of this contour? There is some contour, right? What is the meaning of this? There are some contours like this. What is this? See, the contours represents constant loss function. For example, let me consider some plane which is parallel to this xy coordinates. Xy plane is there, right? This ground surface corresponds to xy plane. If I try to cut this loss function horizontally, then I am going to end up with this ellipse or circle, right? These circles. On top of each and every circle, the loss function is constant. You can see, just consider 20. If you try to cut this horizontally with reference to this 20, then you are going to end up with some circle or some ellipse. That one you are trying to draw here. That means over that ellipse or over that circle, the loss function value is constant, right? Over this boundary. And over this boundary also loss function constant. And over this boundary also loss function constant. See red, right? Red, you can see this red one. If you try to cut this one, if you try to cut this with a plane, then you are going to end up with these contours. That is a representation of this one. Over each and every elliptical contour or over this circular contour, the loss function value is constant. And blue represents low loss, red represents high loss. Our target is we need to approach to this low loss. We need to find the concerned weights, the concerned W1 and W2 for this particular loss. That's our target. Yeah, one of you can answer, is it having only global minima or is it having any other local minima also? This particular function. It's 3D function, right? You have two parameters, W1 and W2. You want to minimize this function, this loss function or error function with respect to these parameters, W1 and W2. Is it global minima or local minima? This particular point. See, this z coordinate corresponds to loss. Yeah, this is global minima, right? Do we have any other minimas in this local minimas kind of thing? Local minima means there that slope should be zero, right? This point, you can see there is a valley, right? Here there is some valley. Here you can find some local minima. This minima is smaller compared to this minima. You can call it like global minima. For this entire region, this is a least possible value. This is local minima. And this can be called as saddle point. Yeah, what is saddle point? Any guess? We discussed in the last class, right? See, saddle point means in one direction that should increase, in another direction that should decrease, but the slope should be zero, right? The gradient should be zero. The gradient at that point should be zero. You can see at this point, gradient is zero. And if you go this direction, the function is decreasing. Or if you go this direction, the function is decreasing. You go this way, or if you go this way, function is increasing, right? These directions function is increasing, and that direction, this direction function is decreasing. In one direction, function is increasing, in another direction, function is decreasing, and gradient is zero at that point. You can call it like a saddle point. Saddle point. And this is a global maxima. This one. For example, if I start my initial guess for weights W1, W2 at this point, can I go to local minima or global minima? Let me start with weights W1, W2. Some W1 I am considering like minus 1. For example, this W1, right? W1 equals to minus 1 and W2 equals to 2. That means I am starting somewhere here at this point. Will I reach to global minima or will I reach to local minima according to your guess? Let me recap that. If you start at this point, will you reach to local minima or global minima? This is global minima. This is local minima. If you start at this point and if you apply gradient descent algorithm, will you go to global minima or local minima?
Global minima.
Global, right? Suppose if you are starting at this point, will you go to local minima or global minima? See, once again, global minima, right? Suppose if you start somewhere here, will you go to local minima or global minima? See, gradient descent algorithm is you'll try to move towards decreasing direction. That's what you are doing, right? This is a decreasing direction. You will go to local minima. If you start your guessing at this point, let's say this is your theta naught, you might end up with this point or W naught. This is your starting point also matters, that initialization, weight initialization. Okay, if you start somewhere here, will you go to local minima or global minima? Any guess?
Local minima.
Mostly you can go to local minima, right? You'll try to go to local minima mostly because you'll try to go towards decreasing direction. With high probability, you might expect this one. You might land up somewhere here. If you start somewhere here, you might end up with global minima. It depends, right? Totally. That means initial point also matters for you. Initial guess for your weights also matters for you, right? This is a saddle point of prendation. You can see this direction, it's increasing. You are at this point. If you go this way, increasing. If you go this way, that's increasing. But if you go this way or that way, that is decreasing, right? So you call it a saddle point. And the gradient at this point is equal to zero. Okay, that's fine. I'd like to ask a question to you. For example, I'm just constructing some ball. I'm trying to keep a ball at this location. Just I am keeping a ball. Will it go this way or that way? Will it go left side or will it go right side? This is right, this is left. See, in which direction that can go?
Left.
It's just a ball. Left side, right? Why? Because there is a valley towards this side. It will try to go this way, that's fine. You can apply that physics, right? It will try to go towards this, that's fine. If I try to keep a ball at this point, is there any chance that after some time this will reach to this point? Is it possible? Is it possible? I'm not adding any extra force for this. I'm just keeping this ball at this point. Do you think it can reach to this point? Will it reach?
Mostly no, sir. It oscillates there itself.
Yeah, what can happen in general with this? It will have momentum like this, this side.
Yes,
that's
sir.
Fine.
It may oscillate there.
It might oscillate back and forth. Finally, that might landed up here, right? Ended up with this. Okay, that's possible, right? It's fine. Suppose I'm keeping the ball somewhere here. I'm just leaving it alone. I'm not adding any force for that, extra force. Then what can happen? Will it reach global minima? See, global minima. This is local minima. By default, due to gravity, that will come like this. Do you think that can reach to this point? Is it possible or not?
Possible, sir.
It's possible, right? Because there's a momentum for this. That momentum keeps on adding to this, right? Initially, the starting velocity for this is zero. Whenever you left that ball at this point, it keeps on increasing its momentum, right? That mv is there, right? You have some acceleration for this. And you can apply that physics, everything. Due to momentum, that can go up to this, and after that may go up to this. Due to gravity, once again, that can come back here, and this might oscillate between back and forth. Finally, that might end up at this point. It's a principle of physics, right? I just apply the gravity and this concept, basic physics principles. Due to momentum, there is a chance that you can escape from local minima. Momentum. In this case, ball can escape from local minima. That's possible. And one more thing, let me have a saddle point. Or let me have a flat surface like this. and this is global minimum. If I keep the ball at this point, is there any chance that this will go to this point? Let go. I'm not pushing that ball. This is flat. It is totally flat.
It won't, sir.
It won't go to this point, right? Suppose, yeah, let me construct the surface like this. And if I try to keep the ball somewhere here, will it go to that point? Then chance that will go to that point. There is some momentum, right? There is some momentum. With that momentum, this can escape from this, right? Due to momentum, that can escape from this plate tube. This is called as plate tube. Constant surface. Constant surface means, what is the gradient of the constant surface?
Zero.
Zero, right? The gradient of constant surface. This W bar is vector. I'm just going for some n-dimensional vector instead of just one dimension. You can imagine that. Constant surface, this gradient is zero, right? For the constant surface. You can try to escape from such constant surfaces or plateaus if you are having momentum. Due to momentum, you can escape from this point and you can go to this global minimum. It's possible. Yeah, let me go to that example once. Yeah, let's consider this picture. This is gradient descent algorithm without momentum. This is gradient descent algorithm with momentum. Forget about this part. Just look into this well-known thing, gradient descent algorithm. Whatever we have seen till now, that algorithm. We are starting at this point. This is a starting point. After 25 iterations, we came up to this point. After 25 iterations. After 50 iterations, we got up to this point. After 75, we just moved a little bit further. After 100 iterations, we are at this point. After 200 iterations, almost there only. 400 iterations, slight variation. 1000 iterations means you are almost there only. Even after 2000 iterations also, you are almost there. Why? Why this is happening? You can see this. Just after 25 iterations, we came from this point to this point. This point to this point, just within 25 iterations. After that, you had an almost more than 1000 iterations. Still, you are at the same location, at this location only. You're not going forward. Can you guess what the reason for this? See, after 1000 iterations, you are at this point, plus 1000 more iterations. It means 2000 iterations. You are at the same point. Why you are at the same point? Is there any guess?
Gradient zero, slope is zero.
Slope is zero, right? Because slope of this function at this nearby, this tangent, that is zero, right? Slope is zero, your gradient won't update, right? Gradient descent algorithm. There is no descent in this one. The gradient is zero. The second term is nullified, right? Your WK plus one will become same as WK due to gradient is zero. This is a plateau. What are I shown in that picture? It's a plateau. You can't go further, right? You can't escape with your basic gradient descent algorithm. Suppose instead of this one, if I go with momentum. Momentum means your initial velocity won't be zero. Yeah, let me clarify that. your gradient descent algorithm will work like this. Gradient descent algorithm. How that will work is, let me say this is my starting point. It's a decreasing, right? I'll try to go with some step. I'm applying this one. Wk plus 1 equals to Wk minus alpha, where alpha is some positive constant, into dou L of W by dou W. See W, see L of W. Like that, you can imagine. See my starting point W0. And this will be my W1. W0, W1. And this might be my W2. And this might be my W3. I am just applying gradient descent algorithm. And what next? Where is my W4? W4 equals to W3 minus alpha into slope. What is the slope at this point? It's flat, right? What is the slope at this point?
Zero.
That is zero, right? That means I am at the same location, right? I will be at the same location. Even if you go for 50 iterations, I will be here. Even if you can go for 2000 iterations, I will be here only. It's a problem with gradient descent algorithm. There is no momentum for this one. There is no momentum for this one means here initial velocity is zero. Due to this slope, I came up to this point after one iteration. And once again, initial velocity for this one is zero. That means I'm just keeping the ball here. Earlier I kept the ball here. After some time, that came to this point. And suddenly I stopped that ball at that location. I stopped that ball manually at this location. And I kept that ball at this location once again. This location. It started with velocity zero. But due to this slope, that can move, right? And after some time, I just stopped this ball. And I kept the ball at this location. Due to this slope, that can move up to this point. Once again, I stopped this ball after some time, and I kept that ball at this location. Will it move at this location? There's no momentum for this, right? I'm just keeping that ball at this location, flat location, after fourth iteration, indirectly. This won't move. That's the problem with the basic gradient descent algorithm. And to avoid this one way you can try to apply momentum. You can carry that momentum. Carry the momentum means, any guess? Initial velocity won't be zero. Carrying momentum means, suppose you kept the ball at this location and after some time you came to this point. You were not stopping the ball. It will start with this particular velocity. See, this is having certain velocity, right? It came from this point to this point. Still, this is having some momentum. If you want to stop this ball, this can move further, right? Due to this momentum, along with this slope, extra momentum that is having. Similarly, if you construct this point, there is no slope for this. If you keep it as it is, it won't move. But due to this momentum, you see, already we have momentum for this ball previous, right? That momentum will be carried and they'll try to go forward. Here carrying momentum is same as taking care of these slopes also. You won't completely neglect the past slopes. You'll try to assign some weights for the past slopes, that previous slopes. You'll try to carry that momentum or you'll try to carry that slope along with this present slope zero. Then that can move forward. That's what you are going to do with gradient descent algorithm with momentum. Let me have a look into this. This is with momentum. Double t plus 1 equals 2. This is t plus 1 iteration. This is t iteration. A t iteration. This is double t. Double t minus alpha into mt. Where mt is the momentum. Mt equals to this one. Yeah, one of you can answer. When this can be same as your gradient descent algorithm, for what value of beta? For what values of beta, this particular algorithm is same as basic gradient descent algorithm.
One, sir.
Beta equals to zero.
Zero, right?
Beta
zero. Yeah. Let me rewrite this. WT plus 1 equals to WT minus. See, instead of this one, I am writing this. Don't get confusion. Instead of this, just remember the logic. Don't remember notations. Where my momentum? Beta MD minus 1. Plus 1 minus beta. P minus 1 is PS, right? Yeah. Oh, this is PS are present. Present, right? This is my present update. Suppose if beta equal to 0, what's going to happen here is mt is same as dou l by dou w at wt. If you substitute this into this expression, that is same as gradient descent algorithm. It's a basic gradient descent algorithm with beta 0. In general, range of beta is 0 to 1. But typically 0.9 is a typical value for most of the applications. In general, beta equals to 0.9. Or if you want, you can consider beta from 0 to 1, open interval. Beta anywhere between 0 to 1. In general, this is a typical value. Beta equals to 0.9. Let me consider beta equals to 0.9 and see what's happening here. What is my W1? Okay, let me rewrite this. Cannot avoid confusion. Let me consider t equals to 1. For t equals to 1, what is my momentum? M1 equals to. And let beta equals to 0.9. It means this is 0.1 and this is 0.9, right? Yes. What is M1? By default, consider m0 equal to 0. Start with m0 equal to 0. Then what is m1? You can answer, right? What is m1? W equals to W naught, right? Yes. W equals to W1. Okay, that's fine. Then my W2 plus 1, it means, okay, I just consider T equals to 1, right? W2 equals to W1 minus alpha into M1. 0.1 dou L by dou W, right? And what happens to my W3? Before that, let me find M2. What is M2? Yeah, what is M2? Point 0.9 into M1. That means this past, right? 0.1 into dou L by dou W1 plus 0.1 into dou L by dou W2. And my W3 becomes like W2 minus alpha into MT. This M2. This entire term. And once again, my momentum M3 becomes like 0.9 into M2. 0.1 dou L by dou W1 plus 0.1 dou L by dou W2 plus 0.1 dou L by dou W3. You can see, I am considering past moments also, right? Past source also. After this, what I am doing is W4 equals to W3 minus alpha M3. Gradient descent algorithm means I won't have this term. I'll have only this term for gradient descent algorithm. And this 0.1 might not be there. Again, but no need to bother about this. For GDA, gradient descent algorithm, we have only this term. We don't have this term. But for gradient descent algorithm with momentum, we have this term as extra. Suppose this term is zero. If this term is zero, your gradient descent algorithm won't update at all because this won't be there for you, right? This will become zero for you. For gradient descent algorithm with momentum, even though this term is zero, this won't be zero, right? This may not be zero, this term. This term won't be zero. This will try to boost this one. That's what happening here. Gradient descent algorithm with momentum. Yeah, let me have a look into this example. This is gradient descent algorithm without momentum. This is with momentum. We just considered beta equals to 0.95. Beta can be anywhere between 0 to 1, right? We consider 0.95. With a learning rate 0.02 for both of them. Without momentum, this is with momentum. This is after 25 iterations. After 25 iterations, this is in good position compared to momentum, right? Which one looks good for you? Without momentum or with momentum? After 25 iterations. Which one moved very well? With momentum or without momentum? You can look into the figure. This is with momentum, this is without momentum. Yeah, which one?
Without momentum.
Without momentum looks good, right? This moved a lot as compared to this one. See, the reason for this one is we have extra 0.1, right? It's not 0.1, 0.05. We have extra 0.05 multiplication. That 1 minus beta term is there, right? 1 minus beta into slope. That 0.05 multiplication factor is there, right? Due to that factor, initially this looks slow compared to this one. That's why this came up to this point bit early compared to that. That's fine. Let me check after some iterations. This is after 50 iterations. Which one looks good after 50 iterations? Without momentum or with momentum? Which one moved a lot? With momentum or without momentum? You can see with momentum moved a lot compared to this, right? The reason for this one is the slope is almost zero at this point. That's why it's unable to move further. It's moving very, very slow. But for this, that past momentum gets carried. This is high slope, right? This term also getting added to this one. Some weighted sum, exponential weightage. And after 75 iterations, this came to this point without momentum, almost there only. After 100 iterations, after 125 iterations, this came almost near to minimum point. But this is there only after 200 iterations. Yeah, what is the reason for going beyond minimum point and coming back? Why? See, why this came up to this point and coming back again? What is the reason? Yes, what is the reason? Yeah, what is the reason for this? Momentum is something like keeping the ball at this location. Due to momentum, this came like this. And this is last grade there, right? Keeps on oscillating there due to momentum. After so many oscillations, that might be ended up somewhere here. Too many oscillations back and forth like this. That's due to momentum. Because this momentum gets carried out, right? This slope is getting carried out even till this point. Due to that slope, that can jump this minimum point, that can go like this. And once again, that can come back. Because this slope is negative, right? This slope is negative, this slope is positive. New terms are negative in this one. Due to this negative slope, this might come back once again like this. It will go back and forth. Finally, that might settle here. That keeps on oscillating up to some level. Finally, that will end up here. Just within 225 iterations, we came to your solution. Even after 2000 iterations, this is at this point. Momentum, just with 225 iterations, you almost got the solution. That's a benefit with the momentum. Yeah, that's fine. Do you have any doubts?
So what is the use of 1 minus beta times derivative of the loss?
Okay, that term. Okay, then that.
If you would not skip this, would it rush very fast?
Oh, yeah, I like that. MD equals to beta times MD minus 1 plus 1 minus beta times dou L by dou WT. You see, if this term won't be there, what will happen is, it's almost momentum is constant, right? Forget about this factor. Just remove this. And I want to update this one. What's happening is M1 equal to beta means 0.95, for example. into m naught, and m2 equals to 0.95 whole square into m naught, m3 equals to 0.95 whole cube into m naught. What will happen here? Suppose my initial momentum is positive. For example, my initial momentum is positive. What's happening is, with this positive momentum, keeps on going, right? Positive momentum. See, you can go up to, for example, 1000 iterations. This value always positive. You can see this. 0.9 whole power 1000 into m naught. It's not becoming negative, right? Always keeps on decreasing. Always this W going like this. Started somewhere here. Always going like this, right? Because it's not changing the sign. Suppose if you have this extra term with you. This slope is negative, right? This slope is negative at this point, for example. Then this term will be negative at some time t. This term will be negative into 0.1. This negative term is getting added to this positive, right? We will try to make this term like a negative. Because our right direction should be this way, right? That should not be this way. This is our right direction at this point. You require this one. Without this, you can't do anything. Yeah, any other?
So not all the terms, sir. Only 1 minus beta.
Okay, 1 minus beta.
Yeah.
With the reason for considering 1 minus beta. That's what you were doubt.
Yeah, sir. Yes, sir.
See, this is some sort of weighted average. See, you have two terms x, y. I want to take the average of both. In general, how to do average? W1, yeah. Forget about these weights. Some W1, x1. Yeah, some other weights. You like to do the average like this, right? Where W1 greater than or equal to 0, W2 greater than or equal to 0. This sum should be 1. Otherwise, you can't call it like average, right? What you are doing is, you are trying to consider weighted average of this new slope with your past moments. You want to take the weighted average of both. Average means this sum to be 1, right? W1 plus W2 sum should be 1. This is W1 means beta. W2 means 1 minus beta. This is called as exponential average. Yeah, that's the reason for this. You are just doing average. That's what you are doing here. Without this also you can proceed. For most of the problems, you can get the solution without this also. I can assume that. Without this also, it's possible. Because this will never go to infinite, right? It's possible without this also.
So I didn't understand that explanation.
What?
This I didn't one. Understand, sir. Average one, yeah. Before this.
See, W1 what I'm doing here is, I'm doing the weighted average of MT minus 1 and new slope, dou L by dou WT. I want to find the average of these two. Okay, average means, for example, 0.1 into MT minus 1 plus 0.9 into dou L by dou WT is one sort of average. Generally, average means people will think like this, right? Dou L by dou WT by 2. Average of both means 1 by 2 weight for this, 1 by 2 weight for this. This total sum should be 1. 1 by 2 weight for MT minus 1 plus 1 by 2 weight for this one. Total sum is 1, right? Here also, you want to make the total term, total sum to be 1. 0.1 plus 0.9. Otherwise, you can't call them like weighted averages. Their two sums should be equal to 1. Then only you can try to call it like weighted average. Otherwise, you won't call it like weighted average. See, this is just a one variant. Don't think that it's a only momentum possible. There are some variants of this one. If you want, you can try to remove this. No problem at all. You can get the solution. Still, you can get the solution. Because this term will never become infinity for most of the cases. No need to control with the help of 1 minus beta. Still, that will work out even if you remove this one. We are just variants of that one. Okay, that's fine. Now just think of this like weighted average. Weighted average means the sum of those weights should be 1 and each weight should be greater than 0. Then only you can call it like weighted average. For example, I want to take the weighted average of x1, x2, x3, xn. Or I can say expectation, right? Weighted average is nothing but expectation. Sigma yes, I, pi xi, where sum of the weights should be equal to 1, right? And pi greater than or equal to 0 for all i. See, that's what we had done here. This is just a weighted average of both. You can think like this sum should be 1, like p1, p2 terms. And each one should be above 0. Yeah, like that you can think. If you want to have clarity, try to expand this further and further and try to see this effect. You can realize the essence of this. You can see 0.9 whole square into 0.1 into this one. If you go for next iteration, 0.9 whole cube into 0.1 into this one, like that, you will have some exponential average. But in our case, by removing 1 minus beta also, we can get the result. There is no doubt. You can have the result without any doubt. Only thing we need to maintain is this should decay. Due to this 0.9 factor, anyway, this will be decayed, right? This keeps on decaying. Or if you want, you can absorb this 0.1 into this alpha. Suppose earlier I took alpha equals to some 1, for example. Now, I can remove this 0.1 here. I can include this 0.1 in alpha only. Instead of taking alpha equal to 1, I'll take alpha equals to 0.1. Indirectly, you can do like that one. By default, that can be absorbed into this parameter alpha. This 1 minus beta can be absorbed. You can absorb that in this parameter alpha. Yeah, nothing wrong with this. Yeah. Okay, any other doubts? Yeah, you can ask.
Sir, what about the effective learning rate, sir?
What?
Sir, like after using this momentum also in the algorithm, what is the effective learning rate? Like, is it impacted? Like, our favorable is initially in the alpha should be high, and after some iterations, the alpha should be low, right?
Yes.
So, like, so our redesigned algorithm supports that or no?
Yes, this is support.
Sir, how, sir, can you please explain that?
Okay, that learning rate. Yeah, I'll go with this example. Right. See, you can try to see this. As compared to without momentum case, with momentum, you are taking more time, right? With momentum, you are taking more time. Here, if I am able to take larger value than this one, I just took 2 into 10 power minus 3 here. Instead of 2 into 10 power minus 3, if I go with 4 into 10 power minus 3, for example, I might end up somewhere here after 25 iterations. From here onwards, I can try to reduce my alpha. I can try to reduce my alpha because I am approaching to solution almost. It's possible you can do. Still, you can try to apply that variable alpha. Initially, you can take alpha to be large. Yeah, the alpha is small. This rate looks smaller compared to this one, right? At least with as compared to GDA without momentum, this looks a bit smaller learning rate. Here you can try to enhance this one. You can multiply by 2, for example, initial learning rate. Instead of here, you might end up somewhere here after 25 iterations. This is good for you, right? Yeah. Any other doubts? Okay, yeah, that's fine. Thank you.